an opportunity to tell them and all the good people that were there a little bit about my ideas about crime, and that focuses on prevention. We have to look at what are the root causes of crime.
Well, really, you can only do three things with crime, right? You can try to prevent it, which is the most cost-effective thing. You can try to rehabilitate, or after the fact, you can punish people. And the Republicans have always seemed to have been addicted to punish people, which is very costly, which makes them big spenders. I looked at the even the president's crime bill. You get $6.5 billion in there. Mm-hmm. $100 million for new juvenile prisons, but only $75 million for after-school programs for youth. Do you agree with that situation? Is that the way to attack the crime problem?
Oh, definitely not. I mean, what we got to do is, like night basketball, what a great program, a great idea, something to involve our youth to get them off the streets, to get them away from situations where they fall into crime. You know, part of the thing that gets me about this continual, let's build more prisons, is they can build prisons until they're blue in the face, but it's not going to solve the crime problem.
Prisons begat prisons, right? That's the more prisons you build, the more prisons you need.
We incarcerate more people than any country in the industrialized world, and it's time that we start working about trying to find ways to stop crime before it happens.
That doesn't make you a bleeding heart liberal?
No, I think it makes common sense, if you ask me.
So, Molly Ivins has said, if we want to look at Texas, Texas locks up more people than any other state, and it's getting progressively more violent. Mm-hmm. And you're in counseling, you have a master's degree. What's the net effect if you take somebody who's nonviolent and lock them in with a bunch of other people who are violent? Generally, does that lead to rehab?
It's a training camp to become a criminal. It's the best way to learn how to be a criminal, because you adapt to the element you're in.
So you're not suggesting that we don't lock up violent criminals, are you?
Oh, no, and make no mistake. I mean, if someone commits a crime, then they should definitely pay for that crime. And any anti-crime legislation that I'll introduce definitely will make sure that the criminals do pay a heavy price for what they do. But, you know, regardless of what they're saying, really the true issue here is that we must begin to invest in prevention. Find strategies to stop crime before it starts.
Okay, after the night basketball, what else would you propose?
Well, I mean, even let's go to our schools first. What a better place to start than our schools? I mean, I would really be a proponent of an anti-violence curricula that's taught to our children in the early grades, teaches them how to solve their problems with their head rather than their fists. An excellent way to start. And also find a way to involve the police force in an outreach program in our schools. Offer them free lunches, or find some way, let them use the facilities there. Get them into the schools in a positive way so they can interact with our children, and they can also act as a deterrent to crime.
Dennis Rittenmeyer, who's over at Purdue, he's the dean in education there, has said that the question isn't the schools being the problem. The question is that the schools are simply reflective of these massive social ills, broken families, lack of community. Are you proposing that the schools in some way be returned to the community and be centers where we deal with some of these social problems?
Exactly. That's another one of the focal points of my proposal for preventing crime, is that the schools become the hubs, the educational hubs, not just for the students, but for their parents and for other members of the community to learn how to make their neighborhood safer, their home safer, and their school safer. I mean, I definitely support the state being involved in helping these neighborhoods to develop and to retain real effective block watch programs, and to help them do that.
Is EJ beatable?
Definitely beatable.
Well, the thing that comes to my mind is he didn't fare all that well in his race for city council a few years back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. He's been pretty well entrenched for the last 10 years in the Ohio House. I think people are tired of that. They see what's happening. I mean, we hear about the scandals where we have these high-priced lobbyists giving money to legislators for doing absolutely nothing. E.J. Thomas has been a part of that system for the last 10 years. People are tired of that, and I think that they're going to ask those people to leave.
Okay, now here's the question. He's been part of it, but are you going to speak out against these honorariums, because it's going on both sides of the aisle?
I know, I would never take an honorarium. And anyway, if I speak, it's because I believe in what I'm speaking about, or I don't go. It's as simple as that.
But are you willing to attack people not only in the Republican Party, but your own party?
I'm willing to attack the problem, and I think that will go both ways, so to speak, in the Ohio House, is that we have to stop letting the lobbyists have the ears of the representatives. The ears of the representatives belong to the people in their district. So, not the high-priced lobbyists.
So if the people agree with you and want to get involved in your campaign, how can they do that?
Call 261-0700. That's the Tom Ernie for Ohio House campaign headquarters.
And you've been doing well so far, but getting a lot of media.
Well, we've been trying.
And
working hard.
The regular viewers of the Democratic left will remember Tom, because he broke me into this type of thing. So if you want to get involved, you remember the First Ernie campaign, very exciting, and Tom's been very active. You've been doing this grassroots stuff, and again, the number is
261-0700.
And not only that, this is a serious campaign. Those of you who remember the First Ernie campaign, kind of the green sign.
We put the crayons away, and we got a real sign.
All right.
All right.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob.
Congratulations. Bob Petrakis here from the Democratic Left, here with Donald Guess, cartoonist for the Columbus Free Press, which I also co-publish and edit. Wish I had a copy here of the new issue. It's really good, even though Donald was on the cover in the December issue. We're going to talk to Donald. Donald's got a show coming up. When's that?
In April.
April?
1994.
April 94, this year.
This year.
Where?
At the Driving Park Library.
The Driving Park Library. The Free Press is distributed in all the libraries. And how long is this show running?
For the whole month of April. There will be, on April the 7th, a reception at 6:30.
April the 7th, the reception at 6:30. I'll be there. Come and check Donald's show out. Let's take a little look here. Take a look at what he draws. Obviously, much of the Free Press stuff is political or has a sharp edge to it. And let's see right here. George Voinovich. Body fat pointing to an apple. A bullseye over the the torso. General assistance program. Does this cartoon suggest, Donald, that Governor Voinovich was doing more than cutting the fat out of the budget when he cut back on general assistance?
Yes, it does.
Graphically, I would say that. What can you tell us about this cartoon? I think, wasn't he in Chicago in 1968, or didn't he beat you up over at, was that the East, what school did you go to?
Oh, Linden.
Linden?
He could have been one of the ones.
Didn't you see him at Linden? What year was that?
That was in 71.
1971, but what's this cartoon suggest here?
Police records are, just like it says, police records are open to the public, and you're welcome to go right on down there.
Okay, and this is another timely one right now. The Fraternal Order of Police have tried to negotiate in their contract the destruction of police records. And Ron O'Brien, who I'm usually not fond of, is rightly in this case saying that that's against the state's open records law. So again, a timely cartoon. The police, Don, why do you think these police are always trying to keep their records closed?
There might be something in them they don't want us to know.
Good point. And we see this Voinovich Bucky theme here. What's this one? This is Bucky.
Oh, that was Bucky because Bucky likes the, he used to like the horses and the police riding the horses.
Is he riding off into the sunset
He's
there?
He's riding off into the sunset.
Okay, so this is when he was leaving office?
This is close.
Close. Again, this is another Voinovich one on the state budget?
Yeah, that was shortly after he got in. And we kind of showed that his proposed stage budget had a lot of leaky holes in it.
This one kind of goes with the fat cat one. But my favorite, this whole, or budget fat, my favorite one actually is this fat cat one here. I don't know, can this be shown on prime time or during regular hours? Because that's got the Buckster getting out of bed with a fat cat, and who's that about to hop in?
That's our current mayor. Lashaka.
Oh, why didn't you put him in lederhosen?
I didn't know what lederhosen was.
Kind of those leather Germanic things. It's okay. This is a prime time show. We don't want the. It's better he's not in lederhosen. So what's this mean? Changing partners with fat cats?
That's when they kind of kicked Bucky out and invited Lashaka in for the mayor race.
And this one up here, this Mother Nature one, what's that one about?
Insurance companies.
Yeah?
Yes, that's what that's about. Like it says, now look here, Mama Nature. We're raising the rates on all your policies because your temper and anger about man's pollution of Earth. Things, earthquakes, are kind of natural disasters.
And what did you do this one for?
There was an article that went with it that was that concerned the insurance companies, as I remember.
Okay. And this one here, this could be my all-time favorite. Who's that?
Why, that's a man named Vitrakis.
Vitrakis! Fight back with Vitrakis. And there, of course, dare I say it, is that Ig the Wonder Pig?
Yes.
And who's this?
That's some political figure named Kasich.
John Kasich. As Bob Vitrakis charges around saying, let's debate. As you know, that debate never happened, but sort of caught in the spirit of that cartoon. What else do we have here? We got Raging Bull Elephant, George Bush. What did you do this one for? Bill Clinton?
Well, this one's just a copy of the original. The original's a lot larger. I didn't bring it down for this show. But it was during the election, and it ran in the Free Press with an article about Bush and Clinton.
Okay, over here, obviously, some statement on Amiraflora. What does this say to the average viewer?
Well, you know, I use this one with the kids when I do workshops and go into schools.
Hype.
I get them to understand the difference between hype and someone telling some truth. And we talk about things like, you remember the commercial for Amiraflora about all the kids having so much fun, like it was an amusement park.
Right.
Did you go there? And they say, yeah, we went there and there was nothing like that. I said, that's hype.
Oh, I don't believe that. A lot of people wanted to celebrate the 500th year discovery by Columbus of the indigenous people who were then raped, maimed, and killed. So how could you call that hype?
I left that one at home.
Okay. You left that one. Here, well, we haven't really talked about this. School board secret meetings, no public allowed. It's like a desperate and pathetic little character here wanting to get in to see what his elected officials are up to, Donald.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I agree with you on that. That was a long time ago.
1988. Do you know what that issue was over? At that point, were they, no one was allowed into the school board meetings, or were they going into that executive session thing?
That might have been what it was. They were going into executive sessions.
And locking the poor public out. Okay. I only see one black man there, Donald. We got a problem here. These look like pathetic white people, particularly that one. Is this a racist thing? Okay. Okay, let's always start from left. My right, your left. That's, well, anyway, here we have that, of course. Is that the famed Billy Emin?
Yes.
Billy Emin, welcome to my Ohio State Fair. What's that secret ingredients? What do we have here?
No gays. Stonewall the Union.
Stonewall the Union, no gays. And what's the one underneath it?
Now, this one was the cover.
This was the cover, huh?
This was the cover.
Just like your famed NAFTA clause with Bill Clinton.
And this one ran on the inside.
Okay, no gays, Stonewall the Union. This man's running for governor right now. He's got your support, Donald?
Nope.
No. And for the first time, we haven't really showed this one. This one is timely again. Dewey Stokes running for county commissioner. But this is when the FOP, when Chief Jackson was first appointed?
Yes.
And what are all these in his back?
Knives in his back.
Oh, what are you implying there, Donald?
Oh, that the FOP was trying to set him up? Oh, I wouldn't dare say anything like that.
Okay, let me see this. Let's see. Competent. He's black. Positive role model. He's black. Tries to stop drugs. Let's see. He's black. It's a reoccurring theme there. Let's see. Fraternal Order of Police, basically a white organization. So are you suggesting that the police might not have been real comfortable with their black leader, Donald?
Yes.
Okay, well, I think you're suggesting, more than suggesting it, Donald, I think you're pretty blatant there. And, whoa, what's this last one?
Why, the buck stops here.
The buck stops here. Very appropriate. It's the last pitcher.
Yes, it's the last pitcher, and that was when he was leaving, taking his desk with
him. It's mine, mine, mine. Buck, on your side, that's why he's taking the city property. Is that right?
Right. Didn't he have to pay $10 or something for that?
So the Buckster, who's now, like myself, who's on public access, the Buckster is now on TV6, Donald. You seen it? Buck on your side?
Back in the spotlight again.
Back, and here's Bob on the left side. Now, tell me the truth, Donald. If you had to take a stand, Bob on your left side or Buck on your side, who would it be?
I think I'd go with Bob.
Okay, it's close, it's tough, but he's going with Bob. Is this fair? You call this fair? Well, you were suggesting that a public spokesperson on Channel 6, the Buckster of Love himself, the Buckmeister, Buckaroonie, was taking city property.
Oh, well, not only did I suggest it, but they had him on every single news channel saying the exact same thing.
Okay, but he didn't look that pathetic, did he?
Well, that's our way of showing him.
Okay, is that a diaper? No, okay, I'm just... Okay, so if people want to see this type, a propagandistic, tear down the system, not mainstream art, where would they go, Donald?
They'll be able to go in April to the Driving Park Library and view this show at any time from April the 1st all the way to the end of April. And then on April the 7th at 6:30 in the evening, we will be having the artist reception.
And Donald is the artist. And in City Hall, they have this Hall of Fame. And you'll see people like the Bucksters. Donald's got all the same people, but it appears to be more Donald, dare I say it, a Hall of Shame? Or is it a Wall of Shame?
I think a Wall of Shame.
Or is it a famous wall, infamous wall? Okay.
I think it's a Wall of Shame.
So Donald Guess, free press cartoonist extraordinaire, the man behind the drawings. What would you like to tell the people now that you're leaving?
Come see the show.
Bob, on your left side. Hi, Bob Fitrakis here from the Democratic Left. We're here with some individuals that are involved in trying to lift the blockade of Cuba. Not only are they trying to lift it, they're actually violating that blockade. This is Ellen Bernstein.
Hello.
And Bill Lewis, the local coordinator with Pastors for Peace. What can you tell me about this effort that you're undertaking?
The effort that we're involved in right now is called the U.S.-Cuba Friendshipment Caravan. This is the third caravan that we've taken to Cuba as an act of civil disobedience to challenge what we consider an immoral and inhumane policy, which is trying to starve the people of Cuba into submission to the political will of the United States.
Aren't they communists? Don't they need to be starved for their past sins? Isn't that what the right wing tells us?
Even if you believe that communism needs to be changed, even if you believe
Well, only the bad communists, because we're dealing with the good communists in China, right?
Right. That's right. China has most favored nation trading status. And part of what we're saying is that whatever differences there are between Cuba and the United States, let's talk about them as adults. Let's negotiate. Let's sit down around a table. Let's not engage in this.
Is Cuba a threat to the United States?
Not in any way that we can see, according to what the United States tells us. Cuba is not a military threat to the United States. Cuba is no longer a satellite of the Soviet Union. Cuba has pulled out of Nicaragua and Angola, has done all of the things that the United States has asked Cuba to do. Every time Cuba makes an adjustment, the United States moves the goalpost back. And the only threat that we can see that Cuba poses to the United States is that people in the United States might start to find out that there's a country 90 miles off the shore of the U.S. that has free health care and free education for all its citizens, that has managed to eradicate institutional racism, that has guaranteed employment for all of its citizens, that has eradicated homelessness. It's a country that prioritizes the good of its people and the good of third world peoples all around the globe. And maybe those values are threatening to the government of the United States. We didn't understand why they were afraid of the little yellow school bus that we tried to bring to Cuba last July. They impounded the bus, and the people on it held a hunger strike for 23 days until the Treasury Department relented and let the school bus go. The bus is now serving the church school programs at the Ebenezer Baptist Church and the Martin Luther King Center in one of the Afro-Cuban neighborhoods of Havana. And if that's a threat to the United States, I sure don't understand it.
Okay, so basically you're arguing that this blockade's a Cold War legacy. What about the political implications, say the power of the anti-Castro Cubans in Miami or parts of Florida? You think political considerations are there aside from other factors?
I think the political considerations are there for sure. The right-wing Cuban Americans have a very powerful lobby in Washington. They have lots of money. And they have paid lots of money to certain politicians in Washington to continue to support the stranglehold that the U.S. has on Cuba. What we know is that that's not the only opinion represented in the Cuban-American community. There have been many Cuban-Americans from Miami, from northern Jersey, who are participating in this friendshipment caravan, because whatever they feel about the Cuban government, they know that the blockade needs to end. That diversity of opinion is something that we celebrate, and And we're also determined that as this people's movement grows, we're going to get to be as big a constituency and bigger. We represent more people than they do. They have more money, but we represent more people than they do. And we're going to get broader and bigger and keep telling the story until this policy changes.
Viewers of the show might remember Felix Rodriguez and Ramon Rodriguez at the right-wing Cuban-American community has been involved in some things other than opposing this boycott. Watergate scandal, paying off burglars, Iran-Contra shipments. So they don't have a real good record. Terrorism in Nicaragua on a lot of these key issues. Bill, why are the local pastors for peace involved in this if this is illegal?
Well, it's not illegal by higher law, to which we're committed. We are part of a network of pastors of peace throughout the United States who believe that what happens in this hemisphere, and in fact in the whole world, directly affects the quality of our own life and our moral character. So as long as an illegal, immoral blockade takes place in Cuba, that compromises our own integrity here in this country.
Do you feel that the people of conscience in a free society should have a right to decide what country that they want to go to? Does that play into any of this, this whole question of freedom?
It certainly does. Not many U.S. citizens know, I suppose, that their government prohibits them from free travel to certain parts of even this hemisphere, and don't believe there's any right for that. The United Nations has condemned this blockade. We're the only country in the world that blockades Cuba. That should stop.
Okay, and to find out more about your organization, who would they contact and what are you planning to do next?
I'm the coordinator for the local contingent of the Pastors for Peace, which is a national organization. I can be contacted. And our mailing address is the United Christian Center, which is in the phone book, 1985 Walden.
Okay, now does this have anything to do with those Marxist nuns that were helping the poor that General Haig told us about during the Reagan administration?
Not that I know of.
Well, you are helping the poor, aren't you?
But we might be very compatible. I'd like to meet them.
Again, remembering the Maryknoll nuns who, an lay sister who was shot and killed and raped in El Salvador and were referred to by then Secretary of State General Haig as Marxists. When pressed for an answer, he said they were helping the poor. An idea, I suppose, Bill, that they might have gotten from Jesus Christ as opposed to Karl Marx, or both.
Well, Pastors of Peace is certainly informed and committed, I think, many of us to Christ. I am, and attempt to do this because I think that's what he would want me to do.
But what you're doing there is you're feeding the hungry, you're helping the afflicted. That sounds like pretty subversive doctrine, wouldn't you think?
It's subversive, all right. And as someone in this group was saying earlier tonight, we wish it wasn't subversive. We wish that were really the mainstream thinking. We're supporting a people who celebrate those values.
So if you want to be subversive, travel to a place, freely exchange with all peoples of the world, learn for yourself, help people that have different ideas that you can learn from and they can learn from you, you might want to support this caravan, Pastors for Peace, and help break that blockade of Cuba. The Cold War's over. Let's retire the last vestiges of the Cold War.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Thank you.
Gus, is it
Vin Harris.
Vin Harris. And Gus, you're originally from Cuba, is that correct?
Yes, I am.
How long did you live in Cuba?
I lived in Cuba until 1980.
Were you born there?
Yeah, I was born there.
And so you spent how many years of your life?
26 years of my life in Cuba.
26 years of your life, and now you're a seminary student at Trinity Lutheran, is it?
Yes, I started here in the Master of Divinity program with the 96 class.
Okay, so as a Cuban citizen, mostly we're used to Cuban citizens, or at least in the media, wanting us to boycott Cuba. You're saying that the boycott is wrong?
When I left Cuba 15 years ago, I was angry, I was resented, as many other Cubans have been. I went back to Cuba in December of 1993 with a seminary class, and when I saw the conditions under which the people of Cuba are living because of the U.S. embargo, I say if I have to waive my personal resentment with what they are going through, I have to give up my personal resentment and I have to fight for their well-being, because actually the situation is just critical and we might get them out of communism but by way of death instead of by way of democracy.
So you favor democracy. You quite literally mean death? Are the conditions so bad in Cuba that people are dying or at the risk of death from this boycott?
Well, 2 days ago, one of my aunts was just buried, and she died. And I would say that she died before time because of the many months that she was without having medication. We have been trying to send her as much as we could, but not always got there on time because of all the travel restrictions and the problems with sending medication.
So there's a shortage of medication in Cuba?
There is a total shortage of medication. Let me tell you this little study. When I was in Cuba in December, we had a grandmother that came to the Martin Luther King Memorial Center because she heard that some American pastors were there with some medication. And all she needed was some penicillin for his grandson that he was dying in a hospital. We gave her the medication and she just kept hugging, crying, and sobbing and say, God bless you, thank you. And that is a representative image of what the people of Cuba are going through. After the fall of the Soviet bloc, they have no source of getting medication.
Do you feel Cuba's a threat to the United States?
Absolutely no. The embargo we have is against a ghost, not against the real thing. Cuba is not a threat to anyone in the world.
So there's no rational reason why we should be embargoing Cuba at this point?
Well, if the United States government wants to keep money coming in from the Cuban-American community, there is a reason, but it's the only one that I can see.
So you just think the right-wing Cuban-American lobby is keeping the U.S. from trading with Cuba?
I think they are a big influence and they have a large part on it. And unfortunately, I think they do that because they live on resentment. They have poisoned souls that don't want to forgive for what they went through in Cuba. And I'm not saying that they don't have a reason to be resented. I'm saying that it's time for forgetting and forgiving.
You went through some of that stuff yourself, didn't you?
I went through some of that stuff myself. But as I said before, if I waive that with the situation that they are going, I'm called by Christ and by the gospel to help the ones that are in need, the ones that are suffering hunger, the ones that don't have medication, the ones that are in those terrible conditions.
Could you tell us a little about your leaving Cuba? Did you leave voluntarily? Did you flee the country? What were the circumstances?
Yes, I left the country during the Mariel left vote, and a cousin of mine from Brooklyn went and got us out of the country.
Okay, and you were an opponent of Castro. You're not a supporter of Castro.
I always was.
You always were? Or
right.
You were always opposed to him?
Yeah, I always opposed Castro. However, I must say that after 14 years in the United States, I have seen that not everything was as good as I thought in this country.
Are you referring to the crime, the poor, things of that nature?
Well, when I think of social justice, I wonder what the role of democracy is in our country. Because
we got all the democracy you can afford. Got enough money, we got plenty of democracy.
That's correct. That's exactly what I was going to say. They say that in Cuba, people doesn't have access to political power if they are not communists. We don't have access to political power if we are not rich in this country.
So again, both of us could improve our visions and our practice of democracy.
Actually, what I think, the only kingdom of justice and peace will come through Jesus Christ and not through human hands.
So as a Christian, it's really the reason why you want people to oppose this embargo and ship humanitarian aid to help the people of Cuba?
It is inhuman and it is against the principle of the gospel.
Okay, well, congratulations on your struggle. Keep up the fight.
Thank you.
I just have a couple comments. Being a layman trying to follow this discussion, I just have a couple observations. Bill Myers indicated, first of all, that 30 to 60 nanograms is what the technology can reach at this point. It's not based upon danger to people or anything else. Now, we've been around with the 17,000 nanograms, which came out in the earlier letter, which has been emitted from this plant. Then I heard about the cancer studies, but then I heard the gentleman over here, I think, say that it's too early to talk about cancer being caused by the dioxins. So the studies don't really make a difference at this point, what they say. I'm concerned that the tests that were given, the inhalation tests, that EPA says they're going to conduct, and the profile that you're going to do on cancer, why we're not doing an ingestion study. Because I've heard the dioxin also can get into food, get into water. We have a lot of farms downstream from this plant. But EPA is not even considering ingestion studies where people consume food. And so is this study that you're doing the best study you can do? Or is there more you can do? My last observation, anybody can answer if you want. In spite of the fact that the Solid Waste Authority wants to have an agreement, implement all these changes, what do we do in the meantime? Would it be more prudent, for example, to only use the boilers as opposed to four every day? Or is this somehow tied to the power that the plant must generate? Would EPA say it's safe to use two boilers as opposed to four until these things are being done? What safe precautions can we use now, since none of us are sure what the effects are? The 17,000 nanograms, which I'm working with, seems to be the highest I heard in the country. I also heard things like the Agent Orange in Vietnam only yielded 60 nanograms. And when I hear things like that, I don't like to hear that we can wait until this fix-up takes place. At the same time, keep releasing this in the air when we're not sure what's going to happen in the near future. And so that's a multifaceted type of approach to it. But first of all, why not ingestion study about the food and the water instead of just inhalation study? And the second question is, what can we do with this planet in the meantime after these things have taken place, since we're not sure of the effects of the oxygen?
Let me first go for the question about why the inhalation was successful. That was done because that was the focus back a month ago about causes of cancer and the effects of dioxin emissions. And it is a methodology that is available right now. US EPA is working on developing an approach to look at these indirect health effects of dioxins and other contaminants. That approach isn't done yet. EPA is working on a project with the waste technology industries, the incinerator in East Liverpool, Ohio, and sometime later this year, they'll have a methodology that can be used. However, the indications are from our discussion with US EPA is that they believe that those risks will be less than the inhalation risks, but they will not be greater than, that they will be the overall less than. So as a result, we focused in on the inhalation risk. We have tools that we can use and get results now.
Well, just as far as we've been told in Europe, for example, that they are quarantining milk from cows because of digestion problems. And that's a serious problem in Europe with dioxin for food. You're saying there's no technology now to test food, to test water with dioxin and see how bad that is?
No, there are test methods to evaluate what the dioxin concentrations are in milk or food, water or air. What hasn't been developed is an approach to estimate if a certain amount of dioxin is released in the environment. How does it end up in the food and through the ingestion process? How much stays in the body and all? And what is the ultimate risk of that certain release of that contaminant? And that's what USEPA is working on.
We'll go to the next question.
Senator Espy, if I could just comment quickly on that, because I think that's why one of our recommendations is a strong recommendation that we need to do that ambulatory study. We need that as the first step in looking at whether there is any potential harm effect on the population surrounding this plant. And I was very happy to hear the Ohio EPA say yes, they are ready to do that, because that was one of our strong recommendations. I think we have to take this in a step-by-step process, and maybe that's the next logical step.
Well, does everybody agree that there are 17,000 anabans coming out of that plant? Does anybody agree with that or disagree?
So you can imagine, that day, that was the result. From this point on, most of the things that thereafter that
Well, even that day was a fluke. We do know it's in the thousands, I would assume. And we talk about 30 or 60 being the best technology to get it down to. And the Agent Orange example I use, I think that's true also. Would that be a reason to be concerned that we should at least maybe only burn 2 quarters as opposed to 4 until these fix-ups take place, to at least reduce it to some extent?
Senator, have any idea at this point in time, even though there were 17,000 plus nanograms admitted in the stack, measured in the stack that day. We have no way of knowing what people are being exposed to, and that seems to me the more critical issue. And I don't mean to sound facetious about this, but we could measure perhaps 500,000 nanograms in the stack. But if the ambient air indicates to us that there is no exposure level of people to that, then essentially there's no health risk involved or very little health risk involved. That still doesn't argue that we should not try to reduce or lower the stack emissions of dioxin coming out of the plant. But I think the key element we're missing right now is what are these people being exposed to, if anything, over
time. What's the time frame on that test?
We would like to get that started as quickly as possible. Bob, do you have any response from EPA when we can do that?
We're hoping to do the monitoring to coincide with the stack testing being done at the same time, so that while the plant is measuring what's coming out of the stack, we will be measuring what is going out of the air.
We expect that test to be done
March 16th. Thank you for calling on some of that stuff. And you're absolutely right. It's a real serious issue.
Yeah.
And they need to, at the very least, I think,
the other thing
keep
is,
the plastics out of it. From burning plastic, the solid waste management plan for Franklin County calls for, they want to burn the plastics that we recycle, even though they know that there's a smell of dioxin and other toxins. So I really appreciate you.
I didn't hear anything that said they're going to do to reduce it in the meantime.
Right, exactly. Exactly.
We'll keep working
on the
environment and reduce it as much as possible.
So that's
our goal.
Okay, so if people are recycling their plastics and they take them down to the city recycling pickup centers that they're going to establish, and then the city is going to take those and
got a man for you, right?
Burn them, then you don't agree that that's a good idea. If we've already taken it out of the waste stream by recycling,
then we don't want it. Absolutely. Okay. We think it should go to market. Anyone who carefully looks at our plan, we believe in reducing the waste stream at the source, the maximum extent possible, recycling as much as possible, reusing as much as possible, burning what can be safely burned, and only burying the residue. That's the way we build our plan on the hierarchy of solid waste options. The city of Columbus has their own plan, and I think theirs is driven more by economics in the current situation. And so, you know, we will continue to work with them to try to get them to do more things on the front end.
Who's the responsible for that, for the city's plan? Who's the contact
The service
person?
Department, Herb Mack, who's the director of public service, yes. And I'll tell you what we're going to start looking at tomorrow, which may be interesting, is, could you just 1 second, Mayor?
A couple minutes.
Nice job.
Okay, thanks.
You have
a couple minutes,
my board is looking at a recycling credit to be given to communities that are very active in trying to reduce the waste stream, and not just reward them with low tipping fees so they can throw everything away. So my board will be looking at sending a price signal back to the City of Columbus saying it costs more to throw it away than it does to do the options. And I think we will use economics to help move this thing in the right direction. That's our goal.
Okay. Now, I know you're on the Priorities 95, and so am I.
You're on the steering committee?
No, I'm on the Public Relations Committee.
Okay.
Or Public Advisory Committee.
Okay.
So I could you are a partner then to get the city to not send their plastics to the power plant.
Yeah. We don't believe there is, there's a couple ways. Whenever there is absolutely no market for materials at all, then we think there is, you know, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to have it in warehouses? We got to work on the market side of it.
Right, and if municipalities recycle, they'll help to build the market.
Right, so we got to work on the market part of it, okay? That came out of this, and closing the loop, that's part of it. Then in addition to that, We don't think there's a problem having enough waste in Franklin County to run the plant
without
in the
plastic.
Of plastic.
Right. Okay. Great. All right. Good. Well, thank you, Mike. I appreciate it.
But I got to point out, all plastic is not the same. I mean, those who think that this dioxin problem is because of all plastic, that is not the case.
No, I understand.
We can't get
there.
But I think the plastics release other kind of toxins besides dioxin that when it burns.
Well, but in a controlled. Once it gets controlled, it should not be a problem when we get the scrubber bag out.
And how long is it going to be before we get scrubbers on all those stacks?
Well, we'll have two of them done by mid-1996.
That's another year and a half, 2 years of breathing all the toxins, though. Is there anything that can happen in the interim?
Well,
and that's what Ben was saying.
I don't know what.
Short of shutting it down.
What kind of emissions do we have? I mean, I'm not aware of what emissions we have. I mean, I think dioxin is the major concern. I mean, if you look at metals and all
metals
things like
and
that, that we're probably not a large emitter of that. We do have. Here's the things that nobody focuses on. I'll go back and get the numbers, but we took almost. I don't want to quote it, I'll be wrong, but it's a big number. It's like tons of lead acid batteries have been removed that would have gone into
before,
the plant.
So you're
before,
removing?
Right at the front door. Uh-huh. We'd give people a buck if they bring us a lead acid battery. We did the same at the landfill. You know, we have our household hazardous waste program. That's an authority program. We took 1.5 million pounds of household hazardous waste out of the waste stream, and we're going to have another one this year.
Do you know what it's going to be?
It's going to be an ongoing. It's going to be a mobile collection program that goes countywide, and it's been 2 weeks in every community. So the authority, you know, we got this problem now, but in fact, we are very proactive on the front end of public education and trying to change the types of waste that comes into us. We don't want to keep expanding waste energy plants. We want this one to be the last one we have to build in this county. And over time, as its useful life goes down, we want to be able to take it offline. That's our goal. So, but we've done a lot of things on the front end that someone noticed.
So I'll go bark up her Max tree then.
Yeah, go see him.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Mike.
Again, it's always a privilege to be working with Bill Moss. And since we're kicking off the campaign there, I really don't see this as a campaign per se, but as a crusade. We are at a very important point in history, and that's why I'm working in this campaign, when almost the stupidest idea seems to come forward. All we know in this country is locking people up. All, as Bill said, all they know is supermax prisons. But here we have a man who knows about supermax schools, about developing supermaximum initiative. So what Bill is going to do is going to be unprecedented. We will have somebody in the legislature in this state for the first time in many of our lifetime that is independent and borrowing that old rhetoric from the civil rights movement.
I have been a voice in this community. I've never hesitated to address the issues, even at times when the positions that we've taken have not been altogether popular, but the test of time has demonstrated that we have been consistent and we have, I hope, I'd like to think, always spoken honestly and with the best interest of our community at heart. And I'm a firm believer that as far as government is concerned, we must work to break the cycle or the center of dependency wherever it exists. Government should do for people what people can't do for themselves. But with regards to services, representation to people of our district, of our community, we want to help the people do for themselves the things that they can do for themselves. We want to be responsive, as I like to think we've been as a member of the Board of Education. And I think the fact that this audience, this gathering here, is what it is, demonstrates that we have tried to represent all the people of the Columbus Public Schools. That idea, that notion does not always get the media play, but we have done that. And I am very, very appreciative of the fact that you have been with me and you have stood with me over time. And I'll tell you something. Now, there's no way that you can be in public service over a period of time and not make some mistakes. I can't think of anything that I made, but I'm sure I can make more. But the fact of the matter is, what we want to always keep in mind is we're trying to do the best job that we can, and we want to stay in touch with the people. And I've always tried to be accessible. I've always been where the people are. That's not going to change. I've never forgotten who I am and what I'm supposed to be about. When I came to public service, I made a commitment that I would represent people, you know, because I was on the air for a number of years. And I remember reading the news from time to time, keeping up with local events and politics, and I would say to myself when I read about issues, boy, if I were in office, I sure wouldn't put up with this. You know, never having the slightest idea that I would actually be in office. But when the time came that I realized that I had to do something, that I had to take some action, that I had to get involved myself, I made a personal commitment. And that commitment was and is that I will try my best to represent people. You know, we have had some confrontations with the power structure. And I believe in business. I'm not in business myself. I'm a strong believer in entrepreneurship, personal initiative, and trying to create resources so that you can do things for people. I strongly believe in that. But I believe in even-handed representation. No one individual is more important than another to me. The guy who's on the street has something to offer as surely as the guy who's in a big house. We're all in this together. And that's what government is supposed and should be about. And as your representative, that's what I've tried to be about. If I go to the state house and you're going to help me get there, that's what we're going to be about. There's some critical issues facing this district, this community, this nation. We should not be so concerned with our own personal well-being that we hesitate to really provide leadership. Leadership many times means speaking out, raising issues, not being afraid to take a position and stand up for what you know is right. And you know, if we do that, if we really do that, commit ourselves to that, things will be better. We kind of shift things up for a time. But there shouldn't be just lonely voices out here speaking up with the issues when we've got a problem with violence in our society, when we've got some-